Okay, so when it comes to about this session, my overall summarized introduction is I'm Syed Hassan Raza Bacha. I'm the managing director of the Ava Creative, and from the about the last decade, I've been working in the commerce cloud industry. And the thing is, whenever someone asks about the commerce cloud, how it actually works, so what actually comes in mind? So just like one website providing some B2C commerce experience. Okay, so this is something a commerce cloud website looks like. This is kind of blueprint that is being provided by the Salesforce itself for the implementation partner so that they can enhance their functionality for their clients and implement the solution. So this is something a very basic and generic website which actually have a home page, some kind of footer, a mega menu where you can see the catalog categories, and you can see the PLP and overall the product and the checkout experience. Okay, thanks Eddie for confirming. Okay, so we were actually talking about a basic Salesforce Commerce Cloud website, which actually providing the homepage functionality and the PLP and the PDP and the rest of the checkout experience. So let's dive in how actually does Commerce Cloud actually works, and a brief introduction about the Commerce Cloud will be covered in this session. The details in this session will be a high level from the architectural perspective, not the technical perspective. I will touch slightly about the technical things, but not about the code things. And thanks for the sponsors, the Park Timing team for hosting me and allowing me to be a speaker over here. Okay, so what are the B2C websites are? And why the experience is very much important in terms of small devices. The website I've shown you, that is actually a blueprint, or you can say a reference website that is being provided by the Salesforce to the customer so that they can enhance and inherit and enhance their own functionalities and implement the third parties in it, like tax and the shipping calculation and etc. So, still, the question is why the screen size is very much important. The mobile-first technique is very much important in terms of any website which is being used by any customer experience. Okay, so the thing is, if the website is not very much responsive on the mobile screens, because the number of mobiles are the greater than the tablets, and tablets are greater than the laptop devices. So this is how the smaller the device is, the more usage and the more users are available across the globe. So if the mobile experience is not very much good, then overall these are the statistics that 57% will not recommend a business with a bad mobile site. So it's really important whatever the website we build in e-commerce platforms, specifically in commerce cloud, it should be very much responsive in terms of small devices. And the 40% have turned to a competitor site after bad mobile experience, which means that people only gives you maximum 3 seconds to evaluate your web page. So people will deviate from website to some other competitor website if they don't find a good experience in mobile devices. So these are some generic you can see the findings based on the group of people across the globe. Okay. This is something overall architecture and how Salesforce Commerce Cloud is actually implementing their solution behind the scene from their data center till our machine and code and how the business manager actually working over there. So across the globe, they have a lot of multiple locations, data centers, They want the bigger data center is available in Europe because this is something considered to be a middle of the world from where mostly the data center is being reserved. But they have shared a lot of backups across the data centers. In each data center, realms are created. Realms is a term where the customer's data has been saved. Well, this is not specific. One realm can be available in multiple data center, and the data is active data is available in one data center, and some other data center should have a backup. Okay, so in this term, if we have an ABC brand, their data might be stored in Europe data center, but have other data center have their backup, so that in terms of if a data center breach or sometime get down, then the data should be available for the customers. One realm can have, you can say it's a kind of a disk or it's kind of hard drive, you can say, which holds the customer A, customer B, or X number of customers' data. One customer data actually responsible for providing the instances, and by instances mean these are the development environment, staging and production environment, and some developer other low-level development environment. These are known as SIG. So let's suppose if a ABC brand comes to me and they want to implement a B2C commerce website, first what we have to do is we first have to go to the Salesforce so that they can provide us some development environment so that we can start development on their reference architecture website. In this regard, every developer will be provided some kind of SIG. SIG is known as a secondary instance group, which are very not very performance oriented business manager or something where we can do the development. Unlike the other Salesforce core development platforms, like using the most people know the Apex language, and where you can do the development online in some business manager. In SIG instance, in the Salesforce Commerce Cloud, you are not actually doing the coding online. Okay, let me show you an example. Here is the business manager where you can do the development, but by connecting this environment to your local VS Code or some other IDE. Okay. Here you have to do is all the time, whatever you're doing, any changes, you have to upload the code, and then you will be able to open your storefront like this. Okay. The way this website actually looks like at the time the reference architecture code is up and running over there. Okay. So this business manager is an example of SIG, which is a secondary instance group. This business manager or the instance is related to only development environment where people can do development, and one instance is usually assigned to one developer. It's kind of a one-to-one relation in one business manager to a one developer in the team. If you have like three, four developers, you need three, four multiple sandboxes or the secondary instance group business managers, so that they can do their development on a feature, on bug fixing. So, then the normal testing of any feature is being done on the development environment. Don't confuse the development environment with the secondary instance group, because development environment is being usually being used for the QA purpose. QA is something where your quality assurance team doing a feature testing or whatever. Once the QA is passed, then the code is being deployed to the staging, where staging instance is just like the same business manager. The look and view is same. Every option is kind of same, but some other capabilities. One capability in the staging environment is you don't use the staging environment for the development. You don't use the QA environment for the development, because these are high level and performance-oriented instances where you deploy the code, set up the catalogs, set up the inventory and the pricing and the locale-based data. The staging environment is only used in setting up the data, and then the data has been replicated toward the production. Okay. The production instance is the final stage of a shipment where the normal customer can come and place the real-time orders. This is a high-level instance environment where the secondary instance group are being used only by the developers. The development environment, which is over here, this is known as development because its URL of this instance usually comes with the development.sandbox, something like that. But this has been used for the QA purpose, not for the development purpose. Okay. Once the QA pass, you set up your code to the staging, you set up staging with other data like catalog and all that stuff, and then replicate code and the configuration towards production, and you are done. There are multiple tiers in a request processing: the web tier, application tier, and the database tier. Web tier is actually responsible for handling the cache things. The application tier is related to your controller's code, which is mostly the JavaScript code that is being done in the Commerce Cloud platform, and the database tier where the Commerce Cloud is actually holding the data. Okay. Don't confuse, the Commerce Cloud is a complete MVC architecture. Usually people mixing this concept with the Commerce Cloud, because normal development is usually being done in the MVC architecture. The Commerce Cloud actually, in my view, it's a view and a controller mechanism of doing the things, while itself Salesforce in the Commerce Cloud domain enforcing that the model or the database should be treated as a third party. You can hold the data in the business manager, but this is not recommended to hold a lot of data in the Commerce Cloud business manager. You should, if you want to save a bulk or the bigger data, you should use a third party database and use some kind of APIs like in REST APIs and SOAP APIs. Commerce Cloud should be used in terms of view and controllers. The view should be visible to the customer. They can initiate their request from view. You come into the controllers. You get and set data in the database as a third party, and you show onto the front end view. So Commerce Cloud is more of like VNC in the MVC architecture. This is the same illustration of the previous picture and previous slide. The data center and the POD instance and the secondary instance group. Basically, one DLM is being assigned. One DLM can host a lot of customers' data in it. One customer data should have a primary instance group, which is being provided in a package like development staging in the production. And for the sandboxes are being provided to their developers to do the development. So this is something a bottom-to-top approach. The development and the coding starts at the sandbox environments. Like if we have the 5 sandboxes, then you can safely assign these sandbox to 5 people, because no one will be overwriting their own code, because at the one time, one developer can work on one sandbox if they are uploading the code. Okay. So I started with the what comes in mind with the Commerce Cloud is actually coming in your mind. Today, the world is actually talking about the mobile first techniques. The legacy architecture was very bulky in the Commerce Cloud. I've been working in the Commerce Cloud from the last around a decade, and I have seen the evolution of the Commerce Cloud architecture. Previously, the old architecture was known as the site genesis architecture, where the request was very bulky. it was something, request was going to the controllers. Controllers doing a lot of things. They are calling the database, getting the data, calculation been doing. A very big response is being passed to the templates. Templates become bulky, hence the performance degraded, and your mobile experience was not very good. So this is something an old architecture website, which was also a Salesforce Commerce Cloud website, but this is Sitegenesis. It's still some brand use this, but everyone is actually going towards the reference architecture, which is the latest architecture. What is SFRA? SFRA is known as the Storefront Reference Architecture. And I have shown you here. This website, which I've shown, is a reference architecture website. It is something built in the view that the mobile experience should be very good, and people should still want to use it. What gets changed into the SFRA, which is reference architecture? Overall, the request processing was same, but a response coming to the front end was very lightweight. Every response is passed to the front end was not actual the bulky object of Salesforce Commerce Cloud. Now they are doing something like that. Every object is being translated into the JSON object and then pass it to the front end. This way, the response passed to the front end very quickly because it's not a burden on the network layer, and hence the performance increases. In the storefront reference architecture, the request processing is really easy to handle. A user actually initiate a request, user sees a view, user's request go to the controller, then controller is actually requesting the data from the model, which is a normal JavaScript files. Well, don't confuse the model over here, database. But you can do the database operation in the model. It's just like models are something, you can say they are some container which are actually getting bulky objects from the Salesforce Commerce Cloud and converting the data which is needed to the front end, converting data into the JSON. And then the JSON object is being passed to the view. So that's the overall architecture in the SFRA. And this small step actually revolutionized the Salesforce Commerce Cloud website, and the request processing was very speedy. The mobile experience becomes really good. While in the previous version, the controller was actually getting the data from Salesforce Commerce Cloud, something like that. If you are getting a product object in the legacy framework, you are just getting the whole product and just passing to the view. A product object can have like 300 different attributes in it. We don't need that. In the SFRA, whatever needed is fetched, converted to the JSON, and passed to the front end. Like if you need only product name and pricing and some kind of variation products attributes, why you need the other 290 attributes? Well, I'm exaggerating a bit. Like still, it has 200 plus attributes and functions. So you don't have to pass the whole object. SFRA was a big step towards request processing. From the demo perspective, I've already shown a bit about the Salesforce Commerce Cloud website. Let me show you here. This is the built-in website I already shown, but let me go through the website and how it's actually working. Let me go to some products information over here. Open some product. Well, this website has been, you can say, a baby website or small website that has been provided by the Salesforce itself. Okay, all the operations, this product page has been created by them, and we can use our own templates to, you know, to override the current functionality, to extend the current functionality. You can use their own functionality and create your own brand. How we can do that, I will be going on to that part soon in the next slide, but let me show you the overall experience of the website. So you still have a lot of information like customer, shipping page, you know, forms are available, shipping methods are available. They provided some kind of example. If you want to use your own shipping methods as a third party, you can use them and you can replace them. You have all the code, each and every bit of the code is available in their reference architecture website. If you want to change, you can simply replicate the same code in your own implementation and start changing it. Well, in SFCC, in the Service for Commerce Cloud, the reference architecture website has been provided as a reference, not for the changes purpose. Okay, so here we have. Here we have the core cartridge implementation example over here. Okay, so as I already told a bit about this, this session will be very brief introduction and how the Salesforce Commerce Cloud actually works. I'm not actually dived into a lot of technical details, but the overall architecture, how the code has been working. The core cartridge in this example is the reference architecture. On top of it, you can build your own brands, multiple geographically distributed brands, you can say. Okay, so let's say if I have to build a brand in US, then on top of core cartridge is known as the reference architecture, I will build my own cartridge that is being US customization or whatever US core. And on top of it, if this US geographical location have multiple brands, then I should build multiple brands on top of my US customer. If I don't have any brand over here, then I'm good till this layer. Like if one website is good to have, like one website have one US location, then if there is no brand needed in the geographical location, then one core cartridge and one US customization cartridge is more than enough. Okay, so this complexity comes when one website have multiple brands in it. How a one website or the one brand can operate with multiple brands, why it is needed, let me show you. There is a capability over here. Let me refresh the page. Sorry for this delay. Okay, I think we're good.
Hassan, we have 3 minutes remaining, so just find out.
Okay, we'll just find out. So one commerce brand business manager have multiple websites available over here. You can manage your own brands over here. Okay, like this. I'm not opening any brand, but this is something you can create your own website in one business manager. Okay. Okay. So let's talk the certification. There is a developer certification available on the web assessor. You can go and register in the Salesforce B2C commerce developer or whoever want to, you know, do the certification. First, you need to do the developer certification. The next step comes with The architect exam for the Salesforce B2C commerce architect. Normally, a developer should be should have like at least 2 years of experience, while the Salesforce B2C commerce architect should have like at least 5 years of development experience. Okay, so this is the development and the certification path you can do. I'm just winding it up real quick way. So any questions so far?
Yeah, you can ask.
What is different between Experience Cloud website and Commerce Cloud website?
Okay, in terms of Commerce Cloud, I have a bit more knowledge about the Commerce Cloud. Commerce Cloud provides you a template level experience where you can change anything. You can, you know, people can use the Experience Cloud in replacement of the Commerce Cloud, but in terms of Commerce Cloud providing you each and every bit in the code where you can change anything from the locale implementation to the template, and you can use the power of reference architecture where you can inherit their existing code and enhance your functionality from there. You don't have to build from scratch in the Commerce Cloud.
Okay, thank you, Hassan.